in the throttle, get a little brake boost, and let it go out of the line. And get to 60 in about 7 seconds.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 23 Toyota Prius. Please forget the parking job, didn't have many options here at the beach. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first, let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. This is the all new fifth generation Prius, and you're gonna know it immediately. Up here at the front, we've got a very thin grille leading into LED DRLs and turn signals with LED projector headlights. Down low is a gray painted fascia with an exposed front air dam. There are also LED fog lights at the corners. This one is painted in supersonic red. It's one of only two premium colors, all the others being no cost. I like this color, and I like it with the black accents like here for the wheel arches. XLE and limited trims get 19-inch wheels. The base LE gets a 17-inch wheel option. These are wrapped in Michelin all-season tires, 195 section front and rear. There's black gloss for the top of the mirror caps, black window trim, and as we step back to look at the profile, here is where we see the biggest stylistic difference with the new model. For a couple reasons. One, they move back the apex of the car considerably, so there's a very gentle slope to that windshield and a nice taper to the roof line. And two, it is 2 inches lower in addition to being 1 inch longer and 1 inch wider than its predecessor, giving it this graduated look. It just doesn't appear like a Prius. And you get to the back, and they really tidied up the package nicely with this thin LED taillight bar with integrated turn signals. Above Prius, that's above some gloss black and mingling red. The new Prius is just sleek, and that's never been a word you could ever use to describe this car up until now. It is a knockout to me. And I can't believe I have to ask this, but do you guys think this is better or worse looking than its predecessor? Let me know in the comments, and let's move to a limited trim to check out the interior. Opening up with the handle up high, and looking inside at this limited trim's black leatherette interior. You can choose gray for the leatherette as well. There are seat perforations, some contrast stitching, and this one has the optional rear heated seats on the doors. Hard plastics up high, leatherette padded armrest here, more hard plastics around the one touch up down windows, and more hard plastics down low. This one has the upgraded JBL sound system. Behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, I've got sufficient knee room. The seat back's in leatherette. No map pocket here. It's just on the passenger side. The foot pockets are pretty narrow to slide my feet under. These are some chunkier shoes. Thigh support is lacking. Headroom is good. My head clears the roof. It's not pressed up uncomfortably with my head back on that headrest, so that gets the thumbs up from me. No air vents in the middle. You do have your rear seat heating controls, two USB-C ports, and not a giant drive shaft hump. So I can slide into the middle seat easily, but my head doesn't really clear the roof here. If you don't have a middle passenger, then there's an armrest that comes down with two cup holders and nice padding. Another option equipped to this vehicle is the fixed glass roof with two sunroof openings. So the back seats of the Prius, we've got enough space here for legroom and headroom, full-size adults, no problem. Would like to see some air vents though. Let's check out the front. Door close noise. Pretty solid, just at the very end, there's a little bit of a tinny sound to it. Smart keyless entry is for the front and rear doors. These front seats on limited trims are heated and ventilated, power adjusting for the driver's seat, manual adjustments for the passenger side. The hatch release button is here, and it is power operated on XLE and limited. And behind the second row of seats, we find 20 cubic feet of space. Yes, it's down from the predecessor just a little bit, but that's what you get with the sloped roofline. Under this floor, we've got a little bit of cargo organization, and you can fold down those rear seats 60-40 for greater cargo options. This cargo cover is pretty trick because it can just fold in half easily and store in the trunk. There's a power close and lock feature on the lift back, which isn't fast. You get power adjusting, not power folding door mirrors, and two position memory for the driver's seat. See a little bit of the ambient lighting right there. Drivers get this heated leatherette wrap steering wheel, which feels great in the hands. I still have the same issue as the BZ4X with the wheel design and this whole driver side cockpit though. For one, these controls just don't look great like that on the wheel. And two, there just isn't enough tilt to the wheel. So I feel like your view is constantly, a view of the gauge cluster is constantly interrupted by this rim of the wheel. There is a 12.3 inch touchscreen infotainment system that is fairly responsive and pretty intuitive. It does have wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto as well. There is a physical volume knob off to the right of the screen. More ambient lighting is seen here, mingling with this metal looking but plastic trim. HVAC controls are in the center. You get two USB-C ports and a DC outlet. If you don't like the shallowness of this storage shelf, you can remove this for deeper options. Two cup holders are here, some gloss black trim that I don't love because it smudges, scratches, and collects dust. There is a leatherette wrapped gear selector, which feels kind of dainty in the hands. Wireless smartphone charging slot. Under the padded armrest is a good portion of additional storage. We've got two more USB-C ports. There is a digital rearview mirror as an option in this vehicle. And visibility is good up until you get to that C pillar. Then we've got a blind spot. Thankfully, there's standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. This cabin is definitely an upgrade over the predecessor, apart from the design of the driver's side cockpit. I'm ready. Let's take the new Prius for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. Some pleasant chimes to greet us, but an otherwise silent startup. Our drive mode is selected here, and we shall begin in normal. To go in reverse, we click over and up, and that brings up a low resolution backup camera. It is a wide angle, and it lacks trajectory lines. In and down for drive, and we'll begin with a turning radius test. Straightened, cranked. Pretty tidy, I like it. Look, we've got another all new Prius right there with Alex on Autos reviewing it. And we'll get to hear the turn signal sound as we do yet another turning radius test. If I like the noise of that turn signal. It's not too loud, but it's just, it's a tone that could get irritating. The powertrain and the 23 Toyota Prius. Big upgrade for this fifth generation model. So instead of the nickel hydride battery system that we've had in the Prius since the beginning of its conventional hybrid life, we've moved to a more modern lithium-ion battery setup, and we have a 2-liter four-cylinder engine with two electric motor generators, and the combined output is a big bump up from the fourth gen. We're looking at 194 horsepower in the front-wheel drive version, and thanks to a higher output permanent magnet electric motor at the rear axle, the all-wheel drive version gets a whopping 2 extra horsepower, so 196 horsepower for that one. Either way you slice it, both have about 215 pound-feet of combined torque. In the normal drive mode, when the CVT isn't complaining, this is a really pleasant driving car. It cruises happily down the road. Thanks to a new hydraulic brake booster, you get that linear pedal feel, so it's easy to come up to a stop. There's not that odd transition between regen and friction braking. And then as you ease away from a stop, thanks to a bump in electric power, it just kind of smoothens your transition. And you feel like you can get away cleanly. These seats are tremendously comfortable.
well-cushioned, supportive shape. And though the ride was firm feeling over those initial bumps in that parking lot, it's settled in better now at speed. Still, you feel like you're being bounced around a bit, but the harsh impacts have the edge taken off them. So you feel like you could daily drive this without being discomforted. Now, as the speeds do pick up, the tire and road noise is considerable. The wind noise isn't really that obtrusive, but maybe it's just because the tire and road noise is so prevalent. This road surface, I know, is not a quiet one. But this ambient volume, this NVH level, could become tedious. I feel like we need to do a 0 to 60 test. So I'm going to put my race box set up here. And I'm going to move into the sport drive mode. And then I'll hold my foot hard on the brake, hit the throttle, get a little brake boost, and let it go out of the line. And get to 60 in about 7 seconds, which is precisely what Toyota quotes for the new Prius all-wheel drive. If you go with the front-wheel drive, then you're looking at 7.2. But it's fun to see a real-world test prove that we can hit 60 in about 7 seconds. And compare that to the 11 seconds of the prior generation. And this just feels like a sports car by comparison. And here's the crazy part. Not only is the new Prius more powerful and obviously quicker to 60 than its predecessor, but it somehow improves upon the fuel economy. Let's go now into the Eco drive mode, the fuel sipping mode. In the LE front-wheel drive version, you have 57 combined mpg. Yes, in this limited all-wheel drive trim, you're looking at 49 combined, but that's as bad as you're gonna see the Prius. In the low to mid 50s range, but you know what, we're not done yet. Let's hop into the front wheel drive version, maybe see how this car handles too. Okay, we've made it into an XLE front wheel drive, the same red one we used for the exterior impressions, and I'm gonna show you the EV mode here, which turns off that gas engine and lets us go completely silent. And this application is really the only time you're gonna use it. If you're just creeping out of your neighborhood, or if you're just working through a parking garage, because the moment you hit 25, or you put in too much throttle, boop, it goes away. And you go back to conventional hybrid. One other handy feature I hinted at earlier, but now we can show, is the increased braking regeneration of the fifth gen model. And it is adaptive. So if we're keeping pace with the cars in front of us, it won't add in a lot of regen. If we come up to them quickly and it needs to slow us down, as long as you're at speed, not crawling along, then I take my foot off the throttle, it senses the vehicle and slows you down the appropriate measure. We'll see this here as we're coming up to a stop. Take my foot off the throttle. See the charge indicator there on the gauge cluster. It's going to increase as we slow up to a certain speed, and then it just coasts along and you've got to do the rest with the brake pedal. And I know you guys are dying to see how the front-wheel drive car competes, or compares rather, with the all-wheel drive. So we're going to do a 0 to 60 with the race box set up, brake boost it. And there it is in 7.4. Not a whole lot off the pace of the all-wheel drive. Now they say it's supposed to do it in 7.2. We faced a little bit of an uphill. This is a real-world test. But 7.4 in a real-world situation, not too shabby. And part of the reason we can do that is because there's a torque-limiting front differential, so you don't waste any of the traction off the line. I mean, as sporty as something with a CVT can be. But the steering is direct and quick. The weight of it is pretty spot on. The communication level is distilled, okay? This is not a Porsche Cayman. But I get enough out of it to feel like I can take control of this car through curves. And while you may not be on the hunt for canyon roads, the way the braking, steering, and extra power layer into this car mean that it's far and away the most pleasurable to drive Prius. That's no longer an oxymoron. And as we move into the eco mode, let's talk about the pricing for this 23 Prius. The starting figure for the entry-level LE front-wheel drive is $28,500. And as a reminder, that is how you're going to get the best combined MPG of 57. If you want the limited front drive, you're looking at $35,500, and there is the XLE somewhere in between there. All-wheel drive for any of the trim levels is going to be an additional $1,400. Now, because this is a first drive, I'm not going to get too deep into the competition. I'll just kind of list some of the vehicles that you would cross-shop as conventional hybrids. We've got, within Toyota's own stable, the Corolla Hybrid that starts at, I believe, $24,000 while getting 47 combined MPG in front-drive flavor. And then we've also got the Hyundai Elantra Hybrid that starts at $25,000 and gets 54 MPG in front drive. I'll save my verdict for after I've spent a little bit more time behind the wheel, but I will say my first impressions are super positive. No, this vehicle isn't perfect. The road noise is kind of loud. The back seats are lacking air vents, and this driver cockpit area is still funky here as it is in the BZ4X. But the styling, the fuel economy, the power, and the improvements that they've made to the drivability of this car just level it up in a way that the Prius hasn't seen since, for me, the third generation, so it's been a number of years. I gotta applaud Toyota, they've done a good job with this vehicle. I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV first drive. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video, subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time!